let's just look back 25 years to 1979, to that day. It was in May, wasn't it, when Margaret Thatcher entered Downing Street. Now, many historians and commentators now see it as a great watershed in British politics, the beginning of a new era, which would bring great change to Britain. But did it feel that way in May 1979?
Not really. I think, quite frankly, the expectations of Thatcher were rather low. And the general view, at least the general view of the politicians I talked to in those days, was that Callaghan had lost the election because of the winter of discontent and all that, and people were fed up, rather than that Thatcher had won it. And I don't think there was any very great expectation that she was going to do marvels at all.
Now, you mentioned the winter of discontent. It was a very divisive period in British politics, and on that day in 1979, Margaret Thatcher said outside the door of 10 Downing Street, "Where there is discord, may we bring harmony." Did she succeed over the next decade or so in bringing harmony to the nation?
No, and indeed she didn't even try. That wasn't her purpose. I had never heard such rubbish. That's the Francis of Assisi prayer, isn't it? God knows what balmy spin doctor dreamt that one up. But she wasn't there to produce harmony at all. She was there to transform the economy and make capitalism work. And she succeeded in doing that. But harmony was the last thing on her mind, and harmony was the last thing she ever produced.
Why was that?
She was naturally divisive. Anybody who is going to make profound changes of that kind, and bear in mind that Britain was a basket case in the 1970s, the economy was absolutely falling apart and would have eventually simply packed up. Anybody who's going to produce dramatic changes of that kind is going to offend millions of people. And she did. The coal miners are a classic example. Coal mining had become completely unprofitable, basically. But shutting it down, that's a hell of a business. And you're bound to annoy an enormous number of people. She did. So that she was the most disharmonious politician I have ever known in Britain. And the Francis of Assisi prayer was pure rubbish.
So was the price worth paying, the price of creating so much disharmony, was that a price worth paying if by 1990 we had a much stronger economy? I mean, what do you think?
Yes, absolutely worth paying. By the way, I'm not alone in thinking that. That's what Tony Blair thinks as well. I saw that his economic advisor, Derek Scott, said only yesterday that the Thatcher changes were absolutely essential to produce the investment boom, and that we wouldn't be in the position we are in today, which is a strong one, thankfully, economically. We wouldn't be in it without the Thatcher reforms. There's not the slightest doubt about that. She was in some ways an intolerable woman. She had all sorts of failings, but by God, she saved the country economically.
What is it she did in particular that created such a stronger economy?
What she in fact did was to reform the labour and the product and the capital market. She produced Big Bang in the City of London. She changed the nature of the capital market worked. She changed the way industry worked because she changed the power that trade unions had. Trade unions had an absolutely a throttle hold, frankly, on the British economy in the 70s. Some of the union leaders didn't want it, actually. They used to tell me in private that they could do with less powers. But their militants did want it. The country, economically, was becoming unrunnable. With total insensitivity and with a will of iron, she simply smashed through all this. That's what made the change.
Now, what about Britain's role in the world? Her admirers would say we were a much stronger country under her leadership. The Soviets, of course, regarded her as the Iron Lady.
Yes.
Others, including Ted Heath, might say we ended up with less influence in Europe. But where do you think the balance lies?
She loathed Europe, of course, and was very, very slow. Indeed, slow is not really the word, frankly, Terry. She never at all, she was myopic about Europe. She just loathed the place. As far as she was concerned, it was abroad. She didn't like it. And therefore, she had no European vision. Her vision was of Britain. She wanted Britain as a sovereign, powerful country. I might add, by the way, of course, a lot of people agree with that. I'm not at all sure that that isn't how the majority of Britons still think, even after all these years. As far as Russia goes, she did something that never, ever crossed my mind as possible. She and Reagan managed to sort of sit it out, and then Bush, and it in the end collapsed. I never thought communism would collapse. I don't think she thought communism would collapse in the Soviet Union like that, but it did. So she proved a very tough opponent for them indeed, indeed the Iron Lady.
And would you give some credit to her for the collapse of communism?
Yes, I would. Anything that... it's obvious what her strong points were, and it's obvious what her weak points were. Her strong points were her iron will. I've never known a will like it in politics, and I've known a few politicians in my time in various countries. I've never known a man of a woman or woman faintly like her. She was as tough as they come, and anything that required guts and will, she could do for you. Anything that required sensitivity, she couldn't. She had none.
And what was it like interviewing this lady with the iron will?
Great fun, actually. I tell you one thing which she did that I am told is not these days so apparent in our major politicians. She answered the question you asked her. Straight out, wham, bam. She wanted to sit and argue with you. And she wanted to tell you the truth. She was eager to tell you what she believed, because she was absolutely certain that if you gave her long enough, she'd convince you. So she wasn't difficult to interview in that sense. Indeed, people have often said to me, why weren't you ruder to her? Because you didn't have to be. If you said to her, but you don't believe in the single currency, do you? She'd say, no, of course I don't. There was no point in being rude. You just ask her, she'd tell you.
But she wasn't terribly happy about the last interview she did with you. Why was that?
That was the Nigel Lawson interview. She was deeply unhappy about it. She's never spoken to me since. Lawson was Chancellor of the Exchequer and resigned over the appointment of Alan Walters as her economic and financial advisor. She came on the Sunday. He resigned on the Friday. She came on the Sunday to do an interview and denied that she knew why he'd resigned. Cutting a long story short, I in effect said, nonsense. You must know. You had 4 one-hour meetings with him. Don't tell me you don't know. You do know. Some extraordinary reason, most unusual for her, she had decided not to tell the truth. I suppose she got caught at it. Certainly her biographer thinks she got caught at it. She was very angry about it, of course. Though I'm bound to say, she stayed a couple of hours after the programme, had drinks after the programme, chatted away, vigorous as ever. But no, she didn't forgive that, and I suppose it's understandable that she wouldn't.